What about this for an afternoon? I'm in big, bright, weird LA in California, my first time here, and I'm going to go to a bar to talk to a guy about movies. Nothing unusual in that, except the bar is the Formosa Cafe, one of the famous hangouts of old Hollywood movie stars. Several movies have been made here, including most recently LA Confidential, and they're going to close the bar, so it's going to be just us. And the reason they're going to close the bar is because, and this is the most exciting bit, the guy I'm going to talk to is Steve Martin, and we're going to watch clips from loads of his movies, and we're going to ask him millions of questions, and we're going to film it all, and you're going to see it.
He's my favorite honky.
Born in Arizona, moved to Babylonia.
Steve, we've got a bit of Smothers Brothers here, which is one of your first appearances on telly in 1969. Let's have a look and see.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Steve Martin.
Thank you. As Tom and Dick said, I'm Steve Martin, and I'll be out here in a minute. While I'm waiting for me, I'd like to jump right into kind of a Socko Bafo comedy routine. This has really been a big one for me. It's the one that kind of put me where I am today. The napkin trick.
Now, is that typical of the kind of comedy you were doing?
Very.
Yes, and
very
why? Typical. Why? What sort of comedy is that?
I think it kind of absurd. I had this philosophy when I first started out, and you know, people were at the time doing jokes. There were a lot of hangovers from the 50s, and comedians did jokes, and they always told jokes about other people. And I decided to want to eliminate the jokes because I thought, you know, you live or die by the jokes. And I thought, well, you know, I'm a comedian and they're the audience, and if I don't do any jokes, I'll bet they laugh anyway. Huh. And
was this very new? Did it feel a very new thing to do?
Yeah, it did. And I thought, well, I'll just leave out these jokes and just do sort of absurd things. And I said, they won't laugh for a while, but eventually they'll have to do something and they'll probably start laughing because it's so stupid. Mm. So that's what I did, and that kind of represents that.
And there's two kinds of absurd here. There's like stupid absurd, but there's also illogical absurd, isn't
yeah.
it? Like,
yeah.
I'll be out in a minute.
Yeah, right. That was just stuff I came up with. And, you know, you're working this stuff out in nightclubs and no one's watching and you have plenty of time to fail and work out something. Yeah. And here it was not even fully formed. It was just sort of a transitional period for me.
The next clip I've got here is from the short film that you did called Absent-Minded Waiter, and it got an Oscar nomination, is that right?
Yes, it did.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about it.
Well, it was actually a sketch that I'd written for the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour that was never on. And when I started getting some success as a comedian, David Picker, who was the president of Paramount, said, we'd like to introduce you to the film-going public by doing a short. And they hadn't done a short in a long, long time. So I said, well, I have this one thing. So we filmed it. And it was directed by Carl Gottlieb, and it you know, it worked really, really well. And I used it in my stand-up act for a long time after that, too.
Yes, and you showed it on stage?
We showed it on stage, but it also played in movie theaters. I remember seeing it, going to a movie theater just to see it play, and it was with this little unknown movie named Rocky.
Expensive restaurant. Pay a lot of money to come in here. They're expecting a professional waiter, so here we go. Professional. Food service. Water. And glasses. Good evening and welcome. Mal, would you like to see a menu?
Yes, we would, please.
Ah, but first I'll take your order, save a little time on that. Excuse me. Now, what would you like?
I'll just have the New York steak medium with a small spinach salad.
Very good. And for Madam?
I'll have some rare roast beef and avocado vinaigrette, please.
Excellent. Now, what would you like?
New York steak medium and a small spinach salad.
That's a popular dish. Another fellow just ordered that. Now, would you like something to drink?
I'll have a martini.
We'll have two martinis.
Two martinis. Now, would either of you like anything to drink?
We'll have two martinis.
Two martinis. Excellent. Now, would either of you like anything to drink?
And what was the effect of this short film?
Well, what happened was I had co-written the screenplay for The Jerk.
Yeah.
with Carl Gottlieb and Michael Elias. Yes. And I had a deal with Paramount, and they got the script to The Jerk and hated it. And they had a deal with me. So what they did was they paid me off, in a sense, and part of the deal was they gave me The Absent-Minded Waiter, and I ended up owning it, and then The Jerk went to Universal.
Why did they hate The Jerk script?
I don't know. It might have been a little new or weird, and, you know, at that time, these kind of movies weren't being done. Mm-hmm. Now they're done. I haven't looked at it in a long time, but I do like it. It has a lot of resonance, believe it or not, for people. I hear about it all the time.
Yeah.
I mean, I had, this was a couple of years ago, a woman came up to me on the street, young woman, about 20, and she said, oh, I really love that movie, The Jerk. She said, are you going to make another movie?
Oh, God, my laugh. Okay, well, we've got a scene from The Jerk here, mm-hmm. and it's the toilet scene.
Okay.
What's your record? When did you last see The Jerk?
I don't know. 15 years ago, I don't know.
Really? Yeah. Really? Okay, well, let's have a look at this scene, Steve. I think it's absolutely hilarious scene.
Come with me. I got a beautiful little place for you to stay. Put the light on. You're gonna like it here.
Like it? I love it! This is fabulous! I mean,
that's the producer.
Really?
Yeah.
This must be the kitchen? No? You know what I could do? Is take this wall and just turn it this way so I've got a much larger living space, plus it'll create a flow into the main living area. It'll be incredible. No, I'll just elevate this about 6 inches. Create the illusion of two rooms, and yet still have that flow. Then I can take bookshelves and put it here. No, I'll put the books right over here. That way I can be relaxing over here. The customers come in and use the urinal.
David.
I won't disturb them. They won't disturb me.
It easy. It's not here. It's in here.
Oh. I couldn't afford this anyway.
Now tell me, this first film directed by
Carl Reiner.
Carl Reiner, mm-hmm. And you worked with him 4 times or something like that, I think.
Subsequently, yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh. Now, what was his style of working? It looks as if it's sort of set up, and then you do your thing in front of camera. Was it long takes and stuff like that?
No, it was. Yeah. It's all regular movie making.
Yeah.
You know, we worked out the routines ahead of time. Some of it obviously is ad libbed, but. He was very good at bringing in story to the movie and bringing in the character and all that. And I was, at that point in my career, perfectly happy just to do gag after gag after gag.
And it was a huge hit.
Huge, yeah.
It cost something like $4 million and made 40 in America alone.
It was a low-budget movie, yeah.
And so the world was your oyster after that?
That's right.
And what happened? You got calls from Kubrick and stuff?
Well, I met, yeah, I did.
Yes.
Yeah, I met him. I actually hadn't seen The Jerk. I think he saw me on Parkinson or something.
British Parkinson?
Yeah, yeah. And so he called me the next day and he said he had never heard of me and that it was a surprise to see something that was just walked out and was fully formed. But it was all new. It was so new. There was no kind of comedians, a recent history before me that made this transition. And so it was all, flying by the seat of our pants. And I didn't know, it was also, had come at a complicated time for me that I'd been doing my stage act for, it's been at least 10 years or more. And I was pretty sick of it.
Yeah.
And I wanted to go into movies and I did this, but I didn't want to do Jerk 2.
Yeah.
I just didn't know what to do next. I feel I'd exhausted my persona. Especially for me, I don't know about the audience, but I suspected that too. Yeah. And I was really kind of blue,
And so you made a very blue film, Pennies from Heaven?
Well, Pennies from Heaven was something, it wasn't a choice like, I want to do something dark. It was something that I loved Pennies from Heaven so much. And I knew it was kind of an inappropriate career move, but I didn't want to do Jerk 2, and I thought, well, this is such a beautiful movie or film or script and TV show that I decided, well, I'll just do it. I said, they may not appreciate it now, but maybe in 10 years when all the sequence of what film you did next is forgotten, it won't matter.
Yeah. Why is it so beautiful then? What is it about Pennies from Heaven?
Well, it's so poignant. Mm. I thought it was deeply original and surprising. Mm. And it's just kind of stunning and weird, Yeah. It's like the dark side of what I did anyway.
But it is really dark, isn't it?
I think it is
really
very dark, yeah.
He's like a foot soldier of the American dream, right. But he can't handle his sexuality.
And it's it's a relentless movie too. Yeah. I mean, it just keeps getting darker and darker and darker. And
why did it not do well at the box office?
Well, I think one, it's a difficult movie.
Yeah.
Two, it featured me being known for comedy, so it was already weird.
Yeah.
It's not the kind of movie that does well. Yeah. You know.
I think it is one of those films that's coming up, you know, people I've seen a few times, and I think the second half in particular is fantastic. We've got a clip here from it. It's towards the end where you're singing, sort of speaking and singing the title song.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a look.
Best things in life was absolutely free. No one appreciated a sky that was always blue. No one congratulated a moon that was always new. So it was planned that they would vanish now and then. And you must pay before you get them back again. And that's what storms are made for. And you shouldn't be afraid. Every time it rains, pennies from heaven. Don't you know, each cloud contains pennies from heaven.
That's lovely. There's some story about running out of budget or something, is there?
A lot of that was going on behind the scenes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That I wasn't privy to, but I think they, I heard later that the producers actually broke into an office at Paramount and found out what they were spending on other movies. So they had a weapon to go to the studio. God, I don't know.
God.
It's like a Watergate tale. Yeah. Maybe I shouldn't have said that.
No, it's fine. So then Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of this film?
No. I haven't seen it in a long, long time, but it sure was fun to make.
Yeah.
And, I think it's a really fabulous idea that almost, made it.
It dazzles in a way, but it doesn't feel personal in some way, you know.
Yeah.
That film that we've just watched feels really personal in some way, you know, that darkness that you talked eloquently about, you know. There's something missing underneath Dead Man.
Yeah, I think it's because it's such a pastiche, you know, that it's hard to have a real story. The story was the hardest part to put together in that movie.
And then the next film was another Reiner film, another film director.
Man with Two Brains.
Doctor Who. A bolder style, it seems to me, more comic book style.
Right, well, that was kind of going back to square one with a big, you know, ridiculous, silly comedy.
Yeah.
And, and that's what the effort was there.
Yeah.
You know.
And then Lonely Guy.
Yeah.
Which it's one I don't like because I don't.
Yeah, I saw a clip of it like 5 minutes on it. I just hated myself. You know, I really didn't like it. It has a couple of nice scenes in it, but
it's something about the character, though. Is it? He feels too sorry for himself. Would you say?
I think maybe too sorry for himself, it's sort of that whole period after that is kind of a dip. You know, and like I didn't know what I wanted to do really. I didn't know. I was kind of going. On some kind of reasoning rather than instinct.
But the next film wasn't a dip, All of Me.
Yeah, no, that was nice. Yeah, that was nice.
We
had a great script by Phil Robinson.
Yeah. Now tell me about him, because didn't he do Field of Dreams or something?
Yes, he did. He wrote it and directed it.
He's very interesting.
Yeah, he's very interesting. He's very smart.
Yeah.
And, he wrote a great script.
Yeah.
And
great idea.
Yeah.
Very Steve Martin idea.
It came from,
if his name wasn't on it, I would have guessed that was.
Yeah. Well, it came from a book, and it was adapted from a book. And the producer, Steve Friedman, bought the book and gave it to Phil. And he wrote it and did a good job.
And what's the story? Just tell me the story briefly for people.
It's about I don't even remember, but it's about a man who has Lily Tomlin enter half his body, and he has to deal with getting her out through the entire movie.
Yeah. It's very good. I've got a scene here, which it's one of the most famous scenes, but it's so amusing I can't help putting it on.
Isn't it awful?
No idea. I can't go in there. That's the men's room. Just shut up and do as I say.
Don't you ever, ever yell at me again.
I'm sorry, but this is not my idea of a good time.
Well, I am not exactly having one of my best days either. I died 5 minutes ago.
Oh, God. You'll have to do it.
I'll have to do what?
You know, take it out.
Take what out?
The little fireman.
The little fireman?
You know, my penis!
How dare you say penis to a dead person?
Listen, lady, if you don't give Big Ed some air, he's gonna piss all over your half of my body!
Mr. Cobb, if you are trying to scare me, it won't work.
And I'll tell you why. One of the reasons why this does feel like a really personal film is that it's about the relationship between men and women, the sort of comic. And the walk here, that took a while to get right, did it?
Yeah, we had to rehearse that quite a bit. And what we'd do is get Lily in a room and me in a room and Carl. And Lily would walk across the room as her character. And then I would walk across the room fully as her character with my full body parts. And then I'd do it. I'd just try to lose half of her, you know, rather than acquire half of her.
Sure.
You know.
Sure. Great. Okay, well, let's have a look at these walks and runs. So, I mean, the reason why I wanted to put that there was to ask about this bigger question about visual comedy. Mm-hmm. Did you try and be a visual comedian, a particularly visual?
Well, when I was doing stand-up, I was very, very visual.
Yeah.
And that's what I admired always in the old movies.
Yeah.
It was a visual thing. I mean, you have Jerry Lewis on one hand, who's only visual.
Yeah.
And then you have Laurel and Hardy on the other hand, who are quite poignant and moving. So, yeah, you're kind of, that's the struggle, is between those two things.
Yes.
And you don't want to see Jerry Lewis be poignant. So you have to be careful about whether you can pull it off or not.
The next clip we've got is from one of my favorite of your pictures, Little Shop of Horrors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Tell me what you think of that film.
I love the film. I loved making it. I started a relationship with Frank Oz. I really like his work. He's going to direct another movie of mine that I wrote called Bowfinger's Big Thing. We're shooting it next summer, and it's me and Eddie Murphy and so far Heather Graham.
Yeah. And so, what other films have you done with him?
Dirty Rotten Scoundrels and House Sitter.
House Sitter.
And I like playing this character. This character's inside me somehow, you know, from teen years.
You said somewhere I read you liked the bigness of his character, or you had this phrase, stupidity with confidence. What does that mean?
Well, that's what you know. Frank brought into it. He said, "I see this guy as really, really dumb," and I said, "Okay."
When I was younger, just a bad little kid, my mama noticed funny things I did, like shooting puppies with a BB gun. I'd poison guppies, and when I was done, I'd find a pussycat bashing its head. That's when my mama said,
"What did she say?"
She said, "My boy, I think someday you'll find a way to make your natural tendencies pay. You'll be a dentist. You have a talent for causing things.
Hey, hey.
Some be a dentist. People will pay you to be inhumane. Your temperament's wrong for the priest."
That's
so funny. I went to a dinner party the other day, and the woman sitting across me, I said, "You look very, very familiar to me." And she said, "I'm the nurse, and I'm the one you punch."
Was that Miriam Margolyes?
Yes.
Yeah.
I didn't recognize because it had been, 10 years.
Oh, God. Now, your next film, it couldn't be more different from this one, Roxanne.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How is it so incredibly different? Why did you abandon this kind of absurd approach to film for a much
This was an interlude, really. This was a cameo appearance, and I wasn't really thinking in this direction. This was really fun to do, but I was thinking, after Lonely Guy and everything, I thought, I started going to rethink everything, and I thought about story. And I said, story is so important. And then I thought about, you know, what's one of the greatest stories? And I thought, Cyrano de Bergerac. So I took it around to writers. I hadn't, you know, I'd only co-written. I'd never written anything my own myself. So I took it around. Nobody wanted to do it. And I thought, well, I'll give it a shot. So I did. And I wrote the screenplay, and, you know, I wanted it to be moving, and I wanted it to be funny. And it was helped a lot with by Dan Melnick, the producer.
Yeah. He seems a very good producer. He produced Straw Dogs and LA Stories, and that's it.
Yeah.
How did he help?
And Fred Skepsy, the director. Yeah. Just, you know, just watching over the script, and Fred too, you know, just watching over and guiding it. And what I love about it is, you know, people like Mick Jackson or Fred Skepsy or Dan, is that you can come up with a strange idea at the last minute, and often those are the best. It's not the idea you've thought about for a year and a half. It's like you might have taken that year and a half to get to the odd, strange idea. Mm. And they're perfectly willing to go along with it and shoot it.
Give me an example of that. Can you think of anything?
Well, I can think of one with L.A. Story, which was I went to Mick and I said, you know, I've had this idea, Mick Jackson, the director, I said, I have this idea for the ending where all the street signs in L.A. All sort of join in chorus and play Amazing Grace on the bagpipes. And he said, I like it, you know, rather than I don't like it, you know.
Yeah.
And these are the things that to me that like make things, these odd, weird ideas.
Yeah. And another very noticeable thing about Roxanne is that it's your first film with a real sense of place, of community, I guess that was all intentional.
Well, it was an accident. It worked, you know, it happened to be that what it developed. I just said it needs to be this for the story. I thought about setting it in New York. I thought about setting it in different places, but I thought I need a place where people all know each other and where they can walk around in the street and see each other and where they can run into each other and have it make sense.
Oh, there he is. Back up a second.
Okay. Flirting with Sophie and Lydia again, huh?
Hey, Charlie, can I talk to you?
Well. All right.
Great. Hi, Charlie.
How
okay.
Are you?
Have
See
a
later.
Good time.
I got it. Okay, was I right?
Yep, it's ugly.
It really is.
Yeah. What I'm going to say is a little forward.
Oh, good.
There's someone I think I should get to know better.
His heart is broken, but, you know, it's like he has a handicap. Mm. And it's not his nose. Mm. It's kind of what he had to do to overcome his nose is his handicap. I mean, he had to overcome the treatment and the rejection. And that's really his handicap. And he overcame it by becoming a hero.
Yeah.
And that's why I think what Cyrano de Bergerac did in the play is he said, well, I'm going to be the best swordsman, I'm going to be the best at something.
Yeah. I certainly think it's one of your very best films.
Thanks.
And I think it's sort of amazing, I've seen it said elsewhere, but it's amazing that it didn't get Oscar nominations. Did it get any Oscar nominations?
No, nothing. No.
And why is that?
Well, you never know. I don't know. I think there's... you know, I think there's a reaction against comedy always,
comedy.
You know.
Yeah. You know.
But that's not a complaint, really. It's just the way it is, you know.
Yeah. The scene I've got from it is a slightly odd scene. It's the one where you're walking down the street and you meet these guys who have just had a brainwave, which is get their cow to endorse their beer. Mm-hmm. Can we have a look at that?
Sure, yeah.
CD, hola! It came to me last night in a flash.
Yeah, what is that?
The thing, the gimmicks, the Nelson promotional cow.
Oh, we're talking to the chief.
You give her a name, Susie Esmeralda Fossey. You put her picture in the corner of our posters, drinking a beer. Teach her to drink a beer. These things work.
I think it's a fantastic idea.
Do you like it?
I do, I love it. I think it's great. Great idea. I think it's brilliant. What an idea. And I was there. I saw it happen. He took the idea. He saw it ripe on the tree. He plucked it and he put it in his pocket. It's dare I say, genius?
No,
but maybe, maybe it is. Maybe I'm in the presence of greatness. Maybe I just don't know it, but I saw it.
not a key scene in the movie in a way. But it's beautifully directed. You know, to shoot it from the back, was that always the intention?
No, that was the intention. Yeah.
Was it?
Because I thought, you know, I mean, coming from the front, it makes it count too much.
Yeah.
But from behind, it's about shape. It's about you know, the way your hands. You don't have to worry about what I'm saying. If you're on me, then you think, what's he saying? What's he thinking? What's he saying? But you get the idea. This is just about walking away. You know.
Okay. And the next film you did was Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, which was a big hit.
A big hit and a very difficult movie to make.
Why?
Well, physically. I mean, what happened in the movie actually happened to us. We had to, you know, we had to chase snow. We'd land in a town and the snow would melt and we'd have to fly to another town and pack everything up and planes would be canceled because it would be snowing and then we'd get there and then the snow would be gone the next day. And it was really a hard film. It was a long, long shoot and it was freezing. And, you know, all those scenes where I'm in a, you know, John Candy's in a huge, you know, parka and I'm wearing a thin little coat. There was some where we just laughed so hard because I was so cold and John was so comfortable. You know?
I'm in the glove. Just nip a little part.
Give him the goddamn glove!
Are we there yet?
No, a little way to go yet. Beautiful country, though, isn't it?
What do you figure the temperature is?
One.
But I love the movie. This is, I think, one of John Hughes' best movies.
One of his most adult movies.
Mm-hmm. His comedy timing, he's really great. I wish he'd direct more.
Comedy comes from the clash between you and Candy, obviously. And if anything, you're the sort of slightly straighter guy that's at the start, at least.
Well, we did ad-lib a lot in that movie.
Yeah?
A lot.
Yeah.
And John Hughes, John Candy and I made a deal at one point because the movie was stretching and we were working long, long hours. We said, we're about 5 weeks in, we say, no more ad-libbing because we're ad-libbing. And we'll cover it, and then he'll ad-lib something, and he turns around and covers it again. He was getting everything and encouraged us. Yeah. We would ad-lib longer than the reel. So he would let it run for 11 minutes without cutting. And it just finally just run out of film.
How much of that appeared in the final film? That
lots. Yeah, especially there's a scene in a motel room where we get drunk.
How's your drink?
Good.
Go for that one? Where you been? You been to Italy? You had amaretto?
Amaretto, and this is a gin.
A gin.
Give me that. Is there a tequila there?
A little Mexican trip.
Tequila?
There you go. Come on up.
Oh. Is this a good combo or what?
No, probably not. Me, I'm going back to Jamaica.
Jamaica, man. Go to Jamaica. Have some rum, man. Dig it. Irie, man.
And the original cut of the movie is 4.5 hours long.
Really?
Yeah. Now there'd be a director's cut to see.
Yeah. The next clip I've got is of Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, made in 1988, which was a remake.
Wow. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Did you see the original?
Afterwards. Yeah. I'd seen it when I was a kid, but we didn't want to look at it before. Kind of intimidating.
And it's you and Michael Caine, and you're two kind of shysters in the Riviera.
Well, I'm the newcomer con man, and he's the old world, lordly, sophisticated, kindly con man.
Yes.
And I have no principles, and he has all the principles.
Yeah. And this character of yours is like the opposite of your character in Roxanne, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Because he's not decent in a way.
And no.
He's pig ignorant, and he's...
Mm-hmm.
He dislikes women, doesn't he? Or at least at the beginning,
he just has no moral ground.
Yes, absolutely. My favorite scene, and it's the one that we've got here, is the putting on the Ritz, where you're learning to be suave.
Yeah, right.
Again, this is visual comedy. It's non-verbal. It's
came from my stand-up comedy act, really.
Yeah.
I used to do suave guy routines.
Yeah.
And one of my big characters was suave guy.
Really. the cinematographer in this was Michael Ballhaus, who worked with Fassbinder and Scorsese. Mm-hmm. He's notoriously very fast. What was it like working with him?
I love working with him. Yeah. He was first. I like the way the movies look, but also I like him. He was a good comedy spirit to have around. He was laughing and he was, you know, he was with you. He was with you, and he was working on the humor. And
why have you not directed Lutz yourself?
I like life.
Uh-huh. And directors have no life?
No. They're there before you. They're staying there after you. They have to go to dailies. And they live this thing. And I like comedy, and I like my friends. And I like coming in, and I find there's too much peripheral stuff to do.
But I would say you would be Mr. with the writing and everything, you'd be Mr. Preparation and working out, and I mean, you devote tons of time to the creative
process. I don't, I like a little spontaneous feeling, and I don't really want to go say that cufflink needs to be, you know, 1 inch larger.
Oh yeah.
You know, well, I've directed a little bit, and the first day they came to me and they said, said, where do you want the trash can? I said, well, I don't know. By day two, they would come and they'd say, how fast do you want the car to go? I go, 25 miles an hour.
You knew you had to be decisive.
Yeah, exactly. And then we'll adjust it later if it's not right.
After Dirty Rotten, there's a big jump to theater. You did Waiting for Godot
with Robin Williams, directed by Mike Nichols.
And now, imagining you, and I didn't see this production, but seeing you and Williams, did you both perform frenetically, as we might imagine?
Well, it's a mixture of both, because it's written for two vaudevillians, in a way, and it's in spirit. So it had both. It had physicality, and it had this incredible, beautiful language, very sophisticated subject matter.
Next film that you did is Parenthood. Mm-hmm. What do you think of it?
I haven't seen it for a long time, but I have. I think I like it. I like it a lot, and it was a good. It was a good movie for me too, because it moved me into a much more serious world. Even though it's a comedy, it's a serious comedy, and it kind of built a belief that I could do more dramatic roles too. Yeah.
But one of the things I notice is that you're in your underpants again in this film. Nearly every film, you're in your underpants.
Just, you know.
Is that written into your contract?
Yeah. I don't know. If you're doing, bedroom scenes with your wife, you end up in your underpants.
We've just seen lots of your underpants. Anyway, what is Parenthood?
I'd like to get into my underpants right now. Well, I do it on interviews too.
What is Parenthood trying to say?
But it's about how difficult it is, even if you're sincere, to get it right, and how it's kind of out of your control.
Somebody at one point says something like, my whole life is have to. It's quite I find it quite a scary film.
Yeah, and it was never meant to be soft and polite.
Yeah.
And it is, it's based on Ron Howard's and writers Bob Lou Mandel and Lowell Ganz's actual experiences with raising children. That's what it was meant to be, a very honest film.
Really, yeah. Okay, let's look at the scene. We've already seen a wee bit of it, but it's the scene where your son finally catches the ball in baseball.
Okay, that was based on two things. One was Ron Howard's belief that these are epic moments in people's lives, that these ordinary moments. And all the running, that came from, I got that all from watching evangelists. To do that on the stage, move across the stage like that.
Because you do it in leap of faith, the same run.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. But it's a very moving moment, isn't it?
I think so. It's about the tiny moments,
This idea of the incredible joy you can get from your child's little
and that the moment is epic in your life, mm-hmm. You don't have to discover America. That is.
I wanted to ask you about the contrast between this. I've got your play Wasp here, Steve. Mm-hmm. Could you say what your play's about?
It's kind of a portrait of a Wasp American family, and it presents it in a very dark way.
Dark, yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's like...
But comedically.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. Supposedly.
It's the same... I mean, parenthood, which is a way about fatherhood, really. I think there's the scene between the father and son in Wasp is, as you say, incredibly dark. There's a line here where the dad says, "No matter what in life you choose to do, I will be here to shame you." Mm-hmm. You know, which is, I almost feel like saying, well, which can it be? Which is the truth about fatherhood? Is it this absolute joy? Or is that, or is our fathers just locked in themselves, incapable of feeling any joy for their sons?
Well, I think in a, I mean, obviously it doesn't, nothing applies to everyone,
yes.
But this is about that cold Wasp style. And by the way, it's not limited to Wasp, and it's not necessarily Wasp.
Yeah.
It just happens to work, you know.
Yeah.
And it's about giving orders rather than kindness or understanding. And it's a belief, it's kind of Calvinist, Presbyterian, American belief that discipline is everything. And it's about withholding and withholding and withholding. There's a line at the end where the father says, the denial, talking about his son, he says, the denial of my affection will make him strong like me.
Yes, that's the other line that I thought was really...
So there's like a deep belief that it actually works.
Okay, the next clip we've got is from the film L.A. Story. Mm-hmm. Where does it rank in your sort of mental list of how good your movies are?
Well, up near the top, because it was such a personal movie, along with Roxanne, it was very, very personal, very personally involved.
You wrote
it
solo without anybody else.
Yes, yeah. Right. And I'm not sure how successful artistically it is. I think it's, almost. Mm. But I do like it because I like, I like its heart and its themes, and I like I love the presentation of L.A. I think that's a very accurate presentation of L.A. When I sat down to write it, I knew exactly what I wanted, which was a love story set in L.A.
Yeah.
And L.A. is a contributor to romance, which became a personified, city.
Yeah.
So, that's what I wanted to do.
And another unusual thing is about it's almost like, although you wrote it, it's almost like an outsider looking at L.A. Uh-huh. Victoria Tennant's character is an English journalist coming to town to write a piece, and the director is English.
Mick Jackson, yeah. Well, he definitely brought a lot to this movie. He really gave it the style, and he knew instantly. We had good rapport on how we wanted L.A. to be presented.
Yeah. It's like René Clair. It feels like a European's view of LA, basically, to me. Mm-hmm. He's one of your, by now, I think, quite a few characters who are highly evolved in some way, highly intelligent, but who basically like goofing. Like when he goes on telly, because it's absurd to be a weatherman in LA, isn't it? Because the weather's all the same.
Yeah.
So he just goofs.
Mm-hmm. So he has a spirit, he has a comedy spirit. I kind of view it as close to myself, so,
Yeah, okay. The scene that we've got here is, it starts with one of the loveliest bits in this little shot of the ordering coffee.
Mm-hmm, right.
It's a single shot.
Well, that was Mick Jackson at work.
Okay, let's have a look at it, Steve.
I'll have a decaf coffee.
I'll have a decaf espresso.
I'll have a double decaf cappuccino.
Do you have any decaffeinated coffee ice cream?
I'll have a half double decaffeinated half cap with a twist of lemon.
I'll have a twist of lemon,
please.
I'll have a twist of lemon.
As far as I'm concerned, there are only three mystical places in the world. The desert just outside Santa Fe, New Mexico. The Tree of Life in the Arab Emirate of Bahrain. And the restaurant at the corner of Sunset and Crescent, because that's where I first met her, and that's where I first touched her.
It's lovely.
Thanks. That's from my belief that romance begins in some tiny, tiny place, and it can be you accidentally touching someone's hand. It can be the beginning of something.
it almost seems like the particular take you have on romance seems to be quite, like, I don't know, like Don Quixote or this chivalrous in some way.
Well, there's a line in this movie, he said, or my character says, this is not how, I don't know if it's in this movie or if I just said it. He says, this is not how it actually is, but this is how we wish it were.
The next clip we've got is from the film Grand Canyon. Now, Time magazine wrote about it, that it's about contemporary unease. It was really aiming to say something.
Yes. I mean, Larry Kasdan wrote it, along with his wife. And it was about that sense of fear we all have always with us.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, in big cities. And you know, if you watch this film, you always hear helicopters hovering in the background and crime scenes. And it's not about angst. It's about personal fear that's always around you.
And what about your character? Who is he?
Well, he's a film producer who makes violent movies, and he makes his case, and then finally he's shot. And you know, it's a tricky, complicated movie. I think it's a beautiful movie.
Yeah. And what happens after he's shot, he decides that he's going to reject violent movies?
He's going to reject violent movies, and then of course he goes back to them.
Why does he go back to them?
Well, because, you know, his character is such that in the heat of a crisis, he's kind of changed, but not really changed. He's changed for a while, and then as the thing gets more distant, it's forgotten, and he's back to what he used to be.
And is he just incredibly weak and self-deceiving?
Well, I think we're all weak and self-deceiving. So, it just, you know, some of us get lucky and get to be moral, and some of us don't.
But presumably he's rich enough, for example, not to have to continue making these violent
movies. Right, but these men, whether it's movies or whatever, they're driven by something else. They're not driven by morality. And if they have to break their morality to do it, they know that their will to do something is much stronger than their morals.
Yeah.
And I think all of us have that at some point, you know, whether it's just the desire to be in show business, you know, at some point you'll do anything, you know, to be in it. I mean, I don't mean anything, but you know what I mean. I mean, I've done it myself. You know, I've done movies I shouldn't have done for the wrong reasons. So, or just out of confusion or not thinking clearly. So, you know, this character is a real person that's somewhere in all of us, you know.
The scene I've got here is towards the end of that very good drive with Kevin Klein, where he talks about the relationship between movies and
right.
violence.
Mm-hmm.
You think just anyone can do what I do? You think anyone can make the crap I make?
Wasn't there something about life force or life affirming, something like that? That's what Claire told me.
This is life, pal. That's what I'm trying to get through your thick, sanctimonious skull. There's always been violence. There will always be violence. Violence and evil and men with big guns. My movies reflect what's going on. They don't make what's going on. And if I happen to make them better than anyone, then I've got a bigger responsibility than anyone to serve it up. Mac, you ever seen a movie called Sullivan's Travels?
No.
That's part of your problem, you know. You haven't seen enough movies. All of life's riddles are answered in the movies. It's a story about a man who loses his way. He's a filmmaker like me, and he forgets for a moment just what he was set on Earth to do. Fortunately, he finds his way back. That can happen, Mac. Check it out.
It's just totally reverse morality, where he should be a decent man who goes into violent filmmaking and then learns his lesson and doesn't do it anymore. But you can hear him here, he's just lying to himself. He wants to do what he wants to do, and he's making up his philosophy to go along to justify what he wants to do.
He's lying to himself, but is he wrong, really? I mean, he's basically saying that violent movies don't make violent people, and that isn't necessarily a wrong thing to say.
No, I think what he's saying in here is that he is just portraying life as it is. That's what he thinks.
Cop-out, that really.
Pardon me?
A cop-out.
Well, I think the films he makes is not really what life is, you
sure,
know.
Sure, One of the things that I liked so much about the style of this film was the way Kazdan constantly seems to connect one character to the other with a camera shot. This idea of connectivity, you know, it's like, you know, this thing that Margaret Thatcher famously said, there is no such thing as society. Well, this film seems to be saying, well, there is, you know, people are connected. You go, you're jogging along and you find a baby in a bush and you do something with it, you know,
Well, this is very, very much Larry's vision. Larry's one of the most moral filmmakers I've ever met.
Yeah.
You know?
We're now pretty much up to date. You've done a film with David Mamet, which he's directed.
Right.
Tell me about it.
That is a very typical, I won't say typical, but it's very typical David Mamet.
Yeah.
In that it's a movie about con artists, and I play a pretty dark character, which I really like doing. It was really fun, and this movie seems to be making some waves at this point. It's called The Spanish Prisoner, and it will be released in America in April.
Did you have a dog when you were young?
My mother had a dog.
What was his name?
Patty.
You now have a Swiss bank account, anybody asks. Crédit National de Genève, code word Patty.
You just opened me a Swiss bank account?
Yes.
Why?
Lavish, awkward gesture. All of 15 Swiss francs in it, but if you ever want to impress anybody, they can find out you have a Swiss account. But Swiss law prohibits the bank from revealing the balance. Thus, are all men made equal? Let me change. Let's go meet the little sister.
You know, I like, I just like working with David Mamet, really. I liked saying the Mamet words and playing that. He likes a very controlled performance. Yeah. You know, it's almost like all inside your head, you know, rather than physicalize anything.
Yeah. It struck me that one of the words you've used most since we've been talking here is the word moral. You've been using it an awful lot.
Have I really?
Yes, and that doesn't surprise me because looking at your films, it seems to me that you are extremely interested in moral problems and working out those things.
Well, you know, I don't feel very moral. I feel, I do when I look back, I am pleased that the movies aren't ugly.
Ugly soul.
Yeah. Because I do see movies and I think certain actors have dedicated their lives to making movies with ugly souls. And so I feel good that hit and miss, at least they're not ugly, that they are something about life that's true. And life can be ugly, but a lot of the films, I think, are gratuitously ugly. Like, you know.
Yes.
By the way, I like those films. You know, I like to go see them. And sometimes I do feel like I've been manipulated in a bad way, lied to, in a sense. And so I am pleased with at least the nature of what I do.
And I was very nervous about interviewing you today. I'm not sure why, but I was. But it's been an absolute pleasure talking
to
you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Oh, do that again. Without the papers. Great,
okay. Cut. Great. Thank you.
I need to go to the loo.
Yeah, okay. Good, me too. Don't forget to turn your mic off.